Okay, so thank you for the opportunity to give this talk. I'm going to talk about our joint work with Alexander Bufetov and Yan Shishu. And the topic will be the conditioning of determinantal point processes, and we're going to prove a certain conjecture of lines and pairs. So let me introduce kind of the settings. So we have a standard measure space and a locally traced class positive contraction kernel. Okay. Locally traced class in L2 of E. And I will denote the determinantal measure associated with this kernel by that case. We have a process X distributed according to the determinantal measure. So in the most basic case where K is a finite dimensional projection, it's well known that the process has exactly n points, C well, equal m. And furthermore, if we take the vectors in the image of K corresponding to those points, so we take for each x, we take the vector kx, which is just the row of the kernel, and these vectors form a random basis in the image of K, where X goes through the points of our point process. It's a random basis. And, or equivalently, if we have a function in the image of K, then it can be recovered by just looking at its values at the points of the process. So by the end of the talk, I hope to prove the following conjecture of Lyons and Paris. Lyons that even in the infinite dimensional case, so if K is a projection, but possibly of infinite rank, then it is still true that the linear span of kx, x in the support of our process, is dense in the image of k. So that's the statement. Or equivalent, also, and obviously an equivalent statement will be as follows. So if we have that almost surely for any function in the image of K, if it vanishes on the points of the process, then it vanishes almost everywhere. So that will be actually the form in which we will prove this. So another result which I'm not going to prove, but which follows from the same kind of technique, is the tail triviality. So for any sets Bn that decrease to the empty set, the sigma algebras associated to the restriction of the process to Bn intersection is trivial. So this is true for arbitrary contractions. Okay, now K is an arbitrary contraction kernel. So we're not going to prove this. So. But it follows from the same technique. So the main kind of technical tool that we will need for the proof of the Lyon space conjecture is the results on the conditioning of determinantal point processes. So I'd like to discuss those. So conditioning. So to some extent, Yan Shi has already said this, but whatever. The basic result is as follows. For any measurable subset, the conditional distribution, so theorem, the conditional distribution of our process, let's say restricted to B complement, conditioned on its restriction to B, is also determinantal, with also a contraction locally traced class kernel with certain kernel K, as I will denote it by CX restriction to B of K. And we're going to discuss certain properties of this operation that takes the kernel K into the conditional kernel. Now, what was previously known, even before our work, is the special case of this, where B is a set of finite measures. So there is a natural measure associated with our kernel, namely mu k of dx, which is just kxx of mu dx. So this measure is the intensity measure of our process. So whenever I say a set of finite measure, I mean finite with respect to mu k. So for this set of finite measure, there is an explicit description of this kernel. And I'd like to write down the formulas here. So we introduce certain operations on the kernel. So for any x, for any finite bunch of points, we introduce the kernel C x1 xm of k ds. This will be basically the determinant txj k at xis. Determinant, and for any subset of finite measure, we introduce another kernel, CB of K. This will be 1 minus indicator of B times K, 1 minus indicator of K. And in general, so this is whose construction is from. Yes. It's just okay. So this, the kernel CX1XM describes the distribution of the describes the Palm measure. So this is the Palm measure. So basically the distribution of our process conditioned on having xi's in its image, in its support, is basically that C x1 sum of k. So this is due to Shirai and Takahashi. And the conditioning on having no points inside B is that C of B of K. So when we combine these two operations, we get the conditional distribution of our process, given that it has points x1, xm, but no other points inside B. So that's this third kernel. But this explicit description only works under the assumption that B has finite measure. So now the.
Sorry, when you multiply, that means a multiplication of kernels?
Yeah.
So it's not the densities that are multiplied?
No, it's the multiplication of operators on L2.
So, Sasha, maybe you can consider writing a little bit bigger because it is okay. A little bit difficult to
Sorry.
See from
okay.
behind.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so so now let me say what happens in general. So when the set B has infinite measure, then the following is true. So if now, okay, we can approximate the set from the inside by sets of finite measure. And the claim is that the dilemma is as follows. So the kernel C X restricted to B and Bn chi of B complement is a martingale in N. It's an L1 log valued martingale. So we have chosen, so now that so there's an important point here. The conditional kernel is not determined uniquely by the process. The kernel is only determined up to some conjugation. But we have managed to choose this kernel in a canonical way, and this canonical choice is such that they satisfy this martingale property. This would not be true if we chose them incorrectly. So we consider the kernel of the process conditioned on X restricted to Bn. So there is a large set B. We approximate it from the inside by smaller sets Bn, and we condition our process on the complement on its state inside B. So there is something happening on the complement. We are conditioning on what we know inside, on the information inside Bn. This gives us a determinantal process, the conditional process, governed by the kernel that I denote by Cx, Bn, Bn. Now we.
The filtration is the filtration with respect to
yeah.
the martingale is the information contained.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. The filtration Fn is just sigma of x restricted to Bn. The Gibbs problem?
The other thing is that this is an operator, so in what sense?
Yeah, it's a martingale with values and operators. Now, okay.
What does that mean?
Okay, basically, one can okay, one can one can say yes. Okay, so the space of trace class operators is Banach space, and there is a well-defined notion of Banach-valued martingale. Basically, it means that every continuous linear functional is a martingale. So here it is actually enough to check the following thing, that for each xi, for each vector xi in L2 of B complement, this C blah 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 of k xi xi is a martingale. So that's a random variable. It's a martingale. So So yeah. So.
Can you say why you have those restrictions outside that are extra with respect to what?
No, because we have restricted our kernel to the complement. Because we're conditioning, eventually we will condition on B. So we only need to know the conditional measure of the process restricted to the complement.
Thanks.
Because inside B we already know it.
Can I clarify? Do you work on the assumption that you have a projection kernel, or is it more general?
What?
Are you working on the condition that you have a projection kernel?
No, this is completely general. The results on the conditioning are completely general. For arbitrary Hermitian contraction kernels. So, okay. So, but I would like to discuss kind of the reason why it should be a martingale. Because when I first heard that it might be a martingale, I was surprised, but eventually it cannot be cannot not be a martingale. So let me kind of let me explain this. So if we kind of stare long and hard at these formulas that they wrote there for the CBK and CXIK, one can see that they have two crucial properties. First of all, this construction that of the conditional kernel does not treat the orthogonal complement of L2 of B inside L2 of E as a plain Hilbert space. We don't care. It doesn't depend on the choice of a maximal commutative phonemic algebra on this space. So it is an L2 E of E minus B, but we don't care about the structure. So these formulas do not depend on this. It's just a Hilbert space. So this is actually a hint that we are secretly do non-commutative probability here. And this can be taken seriously, but I probably won't have time to introduce the setup for that. But this is very important. So another important property is a so-called locality. So locality means the following thing. So okay, formally it means that whenever we have a projection inside this complement in L2 of E minus B, then Q times C B B of K times Q is the same thing as C X. B of chi B plus Q K chi B plus Q. And let me explain what this means. Okay.
Could I ask another question? So this property depends on the choice of the kernel, but your choice is not there. So in this case, there is an Hermitian way to choose the kernel, but you choose the non-Hermitian. So
no.
There's one.
What do you mean? Everything here is Hermitian. The second one?
Yes, and the third one either. So,
no, it is, because the second one is Hermitian because if you expand this 1 minus chi b k into a series, you will see that you will see the sum of k, chi b k, and blah, blah, blah. You'll see a sum of terms like that, which are obviously Hermitian. And well, the third is the third is just this CBX1 and blah, 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 XN of K is just CB of CX1 XK of K. So I'm just saying that this operator that computes the kernel is a composition of the two operators.
Okay.
but it all states within the realm of Hermitian kernels. So, okay, is there? I would like to explain what this formula actually means. So if Q was an indicator of a set, or F in E minus B, what this formula tells us is the following thing. If we want to condition our process on its state inside B, but we only care about the conditioned process on some set F, then we don't need to know what happens outside of the union of B union F. So we only need the kernel on the union. And that's what's written here, that the conditional kernel on F only depends on the original kernel on the union of B and F. But on the other hand, for general Q, as I said, the choice of a commutative on an algebra is irrelevant. So there is no real difference between Q or arbitrary or between arbitrary projection Q or and indicators. So the same should be true for arbitrary Q. And this is this pretty much explains the martingale property, because let me now sketch a proof of the martingale property. So why should this kernel be a martingale? Remember that the diagonal values of our kernel, it's a locally traced class kernel, it has well-defined diagonal values. So these diagonal values are just the expectation of our process. So the diagonal values of the conditioned kernel will be conditional expectations. So they must form a martingale. But on the other hand, the very notion of diagonal value depends on the choice of a commutative on an algebra. So if we choose another one, you can make any matrix coefficient into a diagonal value. So kind of formally, the argument goes as follows. You take any vector xi in L2 of E minus B and consider the projection Q, like here, to be just the one-dimensional projection onto xi. Well, okay, so let's assume that its norm is 1. And now, instead of looking at our original process, we will look at another process, xq, determinantal with kernel kq, where kq is just q plus chi b k. Now, since kq and k are the same on b, then we can identify then the xq restricted on B is distributed the same way as x restricted to B. So instead of working with x, we can work with x. Instead of conditioning on the restriction to B of x, we can condition on the same thing for xq. But for xq now, this c xq restricted to bn of k, c x related to bn k xi xi is just the trace of c. Of kq. And the trace satisfies the martingale property because it's just the expectation of the number of points. So this is pretty much the sketch of the proof of the martingale property. So now I'm going to return to the Lyons-Peres conjecture. But And before we do this, let me do another thing I forgot to do. So these two constructions of the conditional kernel, the CXI and the CB, we have a kind of a geometric interpretation in the case where K is a projection. So if K is a projection, then this thing equals the projection onto the space of functions inside the image of K that vanish at the points xi. And this thing is the projection onto the space of restrictions to be complement of functions inside the image of K. So if B is finite measure, then this restriction gives a closed subspace. So one can talk about the projection onto this subspace. So this description will be important for the proof of the line space conjecture. So, okay, so now.
So in this particular case, the lemma was not a projection?
In which case?
In this case, projections, it's less surprising.
Well, in the case, okay, so the basically, the case of B of finite measure was essentially known. So, and it's, when we're conditioning on a set of finite measure, it's we can restrict our attention to basically trace class kernels. And determinantal processes with trace class kernels are limits in total variation of processes with finite rank kernels, and those can be extended by dilation to processes with finite rank projection kernels, and for those it's elementary. So the case of B of finite measure is kind of essentially known, but the case of infinite measure kind of was thought to be problematic, but due to the Martingale property, it turns out to be actually pretty easy. So, okay, so now I want to write it somewhere.
You have a third blackboard.
Right, yeah, but I don't want to hide this one. So, okay. So, let me do it here. So let me now sketch the proof of the of Lyons-Perrin's conjecture. So, remember, we were talking about functions which vanish at the points of the process. So suppose there is such a function. It is necessarily random because we want it to vanish at the random bunch of points. So random function inside the image of K, and it vanishes for all points of our point process. Now, let's suppose for simplicity that we're working on the real line, it actually doesn't matter. So there is if f is not identically zero, then there must be some, let's say, dyadic interval, some kind of set from a countable collection of small enough sets. There exists dyadic set A such that, on the one hand, F is not identically zero on A, and on the other hand, our point process does not have points there. So So one can find such a set. So the picture is right as follows. You have some points, have a function that vanishes on those points, and we have managed to secure ourselves a little window where this function is non-zero, and there are no points of the point process. Now, let's see what happens to this process conditionally on its state outside of the set A. Conditioned on X restricted to A complement. So what if we didn't know what happens inside A? So by our results in the conditioning, it's a determinantal with kernel. So this is determinantal with kernel CX restricted to A complement of K. And this kernel is a limit of some kernels built from smaller sets. So Bn approximating A complement. But now, let's see. So now the kernels Cx restricted to Bn of K, those are projections. So as I said here, if we are conditioning a set of finite measure and our kernel was the projection, then the conditional kernel is also a projection. And we have this explicit description of the spaces. So since it projects onto the space of restrictions to Bn complement of functions which vanish at the points of the process inside Bn. So this is from these two expressions. So in particular, our function belongs to the image of these projections. Now F restricted to Bn complement belongs to the image of the C X restricted to Bn, Bn of K. Now, the limiting procedure may the property of being a projection does not survive the limit. But here we're not just, it's not just a projection. Its image contains a specific function, so it dominates a one-dimensional projection onto the space spanned by this function. And this property does survive the limit. So therefore, at the very least, what we can say about C, about the conditional kernel condition on A complement, is that it dominates a one-dimensional projection, namely F restricted to A tender to, and well, divided by norm. So, and whenever a kernel dominates a one-dimensional projection, the corresponding determinantal process must have at least one point. Therefore, conditionally on A complement, the process inside A must have at least one point. But we already have a realization which does not have a point. So it falls outside of the support of its conditional measure, which is not possible. So this proves the conjecture. Okay, so how much time do I have?
6 minutes.
Mm-hmm. 6 minutes.
Can you repeat the
argument? Okay.
just the argument.
Okay, so we have a function that vanishes on the points of our process, right? So, and we have found some window where this function does not identically vanish, but there are no points. And now we're looking at the process conditionally on the complement of this window. So, since restrictions of functions vanishing at the points of the process belong to the image of the projection. Since, well, if you condition on such a finite measure, then the conditional kernel is a projection kernel with the image equal to the space of function that vanishes at the points of the process. And here, if we space of restrictions of functions vanish in the points of the process. So the, let's see. So the conditional kernel Cx restricted to Bn, Bn of k, must dominate the one-dimensional projection onto F restricted to Bn complement. Right? So this condition is a certain inequality. It's the same thing as saying that C blah blah times this function FF is greater than something. And the point is that this martingale converges not just weakly, it actually converges in the locally traced class topology. So it converges in a strong enough sense to preserve these inequalities. So even though the limiting kernel may not be a projection, at least it has an eigenfunction with eigenvalue 1, namely the restriction of F to A. And any determinantal process with such a kernel has at least one point inside A. So, but since our process does not have a point, it means that our specific realization of our determinantal process does not belong to the support of what would happen conditionally on its state outside of A, which cannot happen. So that's, again, that was the proof. Okay, so do I have one more minute?
You have 3 minutes.
Ah, I have 3 minutes. Okay, so maybe I could give a hint also how the tail triviality is proved. So for the proof of tail triviality, basically what we it is enough to show the following thing, to show that the conditional, so tail triviality, it is enough to show that the conditional distribution of our process conditioned on this sets Bn, now they are decrease to zero. The conditional of X conditioned on X restricted to Bn should converge to the unconditional distribution, right? Because this, if we want to prove tail triviality, it means that for a large enough collection of functions, the conditional expectation goes to the expectation. And by large enough, I mean, for instance, some kind of continuous functions of the process kind of inside some bounded sets. So in order to do so, we can just prove that the conditional kernel converges. That the conditional kernel, see, now that is in principle not kind of seems non-trivial to do, but again it's enough to prove this for a single vector, right? Enough to prove that C blah blah xi xi converges to k xi xi, where k is xi is orthogonal to L2 of Bn. And again, we use locality. So this if our measure space had an atom and we were talking about the value of the diagonal value of the kernel inside that atom, that would be just the six xi would be just the probability of having a point inside that atom. And for such probabilities, there is a known calculation due to Lyons, which establishes that indeed the diagonal value of the kernel converges. So essentially, Lyons proved this tail triviality for the discrete case using this calculation. And in a continuous case, well, it's not clear what to do, What we propose is to use locality to essentially reduce to the discrete case. So, yeah. Thank you.